Postgraduate Institute of Medical Science at Lucknow, UP. With this, I give the mic to Ranjanee.
Thank you for the warm introduction. I begin warm wishes from Apollo Hospitals, Chennai. I chose this topic because I felt it is very apt actually for this occasion, and I hope at the end of the discussion I would have done justice to the topic. So going straight away. So the outline would be physician nephrologist link. Physician nephrologist link. What is the need to liaison? What is the physician's role in chronic kidney disease and in other conditions? So physicians and nephrologists work very differently. Primary care physician normally is a jack of all trades. He caters to the community and he is very good at triaging. And he does a rapid screening of abnormal from normal, and he can think out of the box better. And he provides more of a holistic approach, and the bond between the doctor and the patient is much stronger. But he works a little independently. In contrast, the nephrologist is a master of one, and he especially caters to the at-risk population and also identifies the problem and manages the affected group only. And now the times of subspecialty being very on the higher side, he has got a narrow or a limited vision, and he provides more of an individual approach. But he depends on referral basically. So when they work very differently, what is the need to liaison? So there's a huge CKD burden, and less than 10% of the population are screened for CKD in its early stages, and around 40% of the diabetic and hypertension make up for the dialysis, and only 25% of the people get benefit from the AC inhibitors, and around 50% of patients start dialysis without prior exposure to the nephrologist. So change in the risk factors, habits, demand, time, good rapport, and sincere effort, which can be properly given by a physician. So if the patient is not referred appropriately, the complications can be there, and the complete remission cannot occur, which can normally occur only within 3 months of the kidney injury, beyond which we are just left with giving the rehabilitation. Unfortunately, we are still dealing with a form of palliative only, and the real medicine as curative medicine has not developed, because we are still only concentrating on renal replacement therapy in the form of either dialysis or a transplant, which are not, again, without any complications. So physician is an integral part of government health policies and national health programs. So without whose cooperation, we cannot go forward. So physician plays a very important role. So there's an interesting study which says that the late referral has got increased risk of mortality. And in addition, we can see some other benefits like better understanding of the disease and better care. We can avoid the complication if not postpone or prevent chronic kidney disease. And continued care is assured. And knowledge of nephrology practices for a physician is very handy and is must. And because I believe that nephrology is just an extension of medicine. So it's very important, because we don't see different things, but we just see things in a different fashion. Last but not the least, they will definitely have a scope for a mutual growth in knowledge. So this is a graph which says that when the patient is diagnosed with chronic kidney disease, there is a normal rate of kidney function loss. And there are various factors which can cause kidney injury in the form of either an NSAID injury or a contrast-related injury or an infection because of any drug. So in case if these things are not identified on time, the progression to the ESRD can occur very fast. So it's very important to detect the conditions or the risk factors pretty early and attack them appropriately on time. So there are various different conditions for which a patient is being referred to a nephrologist. That is mainly the fall in GFR which is more than 4 ml per minute, or if there is a persistent hematuria or a proteinuria, or for a nephrotic rupture, or incidentally when the ultrasound is done, any malformation is picked up, or the size is small, or is there any scar, or any polycystic kidney disease, or a calcify or obstruction. And also in special cases like pregnancy with a urinary infection, hypertension or a proteinuria, or in late stages of chronic kidney disease, and if it's a difficult to treat hypertension. So now we know that for what all conditions the patients are referred to nephrologist. So now we just see that what is the physician's role in chronic kidney disease and acute kidney injury. So first is the chronic kidney disease. So there's an I just say that physicians are a first line of defense against chronic kidney disease, because they play a very important role in early diagnosis, treatment, and patient education. And also, by simply controlling blood pressure, sugars and lipids and proteinuria, we can go a long way and delay the complications of chronic disease and delay the ESRD. India has got a population of 1.34 billion with a CKD prevalence of around 800 per billion population, but we are only very few nephrologists and very few dialysis centers and few patients on peritoneal dialysis. It's also a costly treatment. So definitely there's a need for a physician to pitch in. This is a KDO classification of a chronic kidney disease, which says that the green zone is a safer zone where the albuminuria is normal, that is, it is up to 30 milligram per day, and also the GFR is above 60. So the when it is slipping into yellow, orange or a red zone, the worsening is there. So this is only this is a small area of a safe zone. So there are various risk factors for kidney disease. The common being hypertension, diabetes, systemic infection, stone disease or neoplasia, which everybody is aware of. And there's a hypothesis that when there is a maladaptation between the nephron number and the solute load, the kidney injury occurs. So if it's there for a short period of time, the hyperfiltration tries to control the situation well, and there is restoration of the solute load and the solute concentration is maintained. But if this prolongs for a long time, progressive loss in nephron number occurs and kidney disease initiates and progresses. So now we'll see the various factors which can be dealt by a physician in an effective manner and the kidney disease can be attacked. So first in the smoking, it not only injures the lung, it can also affect the kidney disease. It is an important contributor for a diabetic nephropathy progression, both type 1 and type 2. And also it is associated with hypertensive retinopathy, IgA nephropathy, lupus and autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease. Similarly, alcohol, both acute and chronic alcohol consumption is associated with renal dysfunction. Acute is mainly associated with electrolyte abnormalities, whereas chronic alcoholism is associated with hypertension risk and risk of hyperuricemia and gout. Obesity is a pandemic now. Now we know that it's a part of metabolic syndrome, hypertension, diabetes, leptin. All these contribute to a difficult milieu and a chronic kidney disease. It's a modifiable risk factor, and on biopsy we normally see a rhomboembolic or a focal sclerosis. Sleep apnea is associated with obesity. Important thing we should remember is GFR estimation is not perfect in them, and the Cockcroft-Gall formula and the MDRD is not suitable. We need to rely on other formula like CKD-EPI in these patients. And also the BMI, which is normally calculated, it does not correlate with the visceral fat. It only sees the subcutaneous fat, so it is important to maintain the to check the waist-hip ratio. And these patients are a little problematic because the dialysis access is an issue with them, and also the difficult peritransplant period. So weight loss and ACE inhibitors will definitely offer a lot of benefit, and it is advantageous to treat them beforehand before they reach the stage of 4 and 5. Dyslipidemia is a highly atherogenic lipid profile, and CKD individuals have all the parameters which are deranged. Not only the kidney patients, also the patients who are on dialysis, both HD and PD, they have dyslipidemia. Similarly, the glucotoxicity also contributes to kidney disease because it can contribute to glomerular hypertension, increase in the reactive oxygen species, increase in the advanced glycosylation end products, and disbalance in the angiogenic and the anti-angiogenic factors. So this is we have a temporal association of the duration of the kidney duration of the diabetes with the findings of the with the worsening of the kidney disease, especially in the diabetes type 1. So normally, which is the stage 3 of microglomeria, which is normally picked up by investigation, it normally occurs 7 to 15 years after initiation of the diabetes. But we can see that already the structural damage has already happened. So we have to pick this, at least this stage, very early and appropriately, because this is a stage of reversibility beyond which it becomes a stage of irreversibility. But this temporal association is not seen in type 2 diabetic individuals because they already have hypertension, nephropathy and retinopathy at the time of diagnosis, and it is also correlating more with vascular abnormality and endothelial dysfunction. So what is the importance of albuminuria? It is not only a marker of chronic disease, also gives a clue to other conditions of glomerulopathy and transplant glomerulopathy. It is also a prognostic indicator because we have already seen that it is associated with cardiovascular risk, and it, but it is modifiable, and it also is considered as a surrogate goal. Hyperuricemia is normally a end result of impaired renal excretion of uric acid. So it is seen as a consequence of kidney disease, but can this be also an initiator of kidney disease? So now the studies have shown that without, in the absence of uric acid nephrolithiasis, also patient can be at increased risk of kidney disease because it can contribute to the reactive oxygen species and endothelial dysfunction, thereby contributing to hypertension, cardiovascular disease, and chronic kidney disease. So coming to thyroid, both hypo and hyperthyroid can be associated with kidney disease. See the thyroid hormone can act on the blood vessels, and it can reduce the systemic vascular resistance, thereby increasing the renin angiotensin activation, thereby causing sodium reabsorption and increasing the blood flow and increasing the GFR. And the reverse is true with happens with hypothyroidism. So both hypo and hyper can contribute to chronic kidney disease. So they are the important factors which are also contributing to chronic kidney disease. So it's important to pick up in a normal day-to-day practice also when the patient comes, and if they are at risk, these tests can be done in a very easy way, and if picked up early, can prevent and can postpone the kidney disease for a long time. Cardiovascular disease is the most important cause of death in chronic kidney disease. So this pictorial diagram says that if there is a phosphate retention with time, anemia, inflammation, sodium retention, all this can contribute to left ventricular hypertrophy, vascular calcification, and thereby increasing the morbidity and mortality. Anemia, which is in chronic kidney disease basically because of the relative deficiency of erythropoietin, is also in addition to that, iron deficiency, anemia, folate deficiency, and vitamin B12 can also contribute. It can increase the cardiac workout, thereby contributing to dilated cardiomyopathy and ischemic heart disease, and thereby causing congestive cardiac failure, myocardial infarction. Hypertension is an independent risk factor for a renal disease progression, and it's associated with left ventricular hypertrophy, cardiac failure, and ischemic heart disease. Systolic blood pressure or increased pulse pressure predicts cardiovascular events, whereas diastolic pressure has got an inverse relationship. So better control of systolic hypertension is more important. So this is the table which says that this is the stage of kidney disease, and the advantage is that according to the stage, we can plan the treatment. So initial stages, we have to diagnose, treat, and assess the progression up till the stage 2. Stage 3 is the stage where complications already set in. So up till the late stage 3, the patient has to be referred to a nephrologist where he can prepare for the patient for renal replacement therapy in the form of access creation in stage 4. And the stage 5, the patient is actually ready for renal replacement therapy, and or he can be planned for renal transplant. So this is again to just show that what are the various modalities with which we can intervene in various stages and treat the complications. And also we need to think about the comorbidities in the form of cardiac disease, vascular disease, neuropathy, and retinopathy, and appropriately refer on time. This is the most important slide, which says that smoking cessation, exercise, dietary salt reduction, weight loss at all CKD stages is applicable. Control of hypertension to usual goals are lower to slow the chronic disease progression. There's a role of aspirin when the GFR is below 45, and BP control is more important than the means by which. It is not that which drug is being used to control. It is the achievement of target which is much more important. So this clearly says that in the initial stages up to the stage 3, there's an important role of a primary health provider who diagnoses the condition and treats the complications prior. And then up till the stage 3 and late stage 3, the patient is being referred to a nephrologist where the patient is being advised on access creation and renal replacement therapy. So now, I think we are convinced that the patient has to be referred because both have got a vital role to play. So just to consolidate, management of complications which can be done better by a nephrologist, preparation for a renal replacement therapy, and if it's a difficult to control hypertension, especially actually diuretics with the worsening stage of chronic kidney disease, more diuretic dose is required to achieve the same target level. So this can be done better by a specialist. There's a decreased need for insulin because excretion is via renal system, and as the disease progresses, the patient needs more time and attention from the specialist. Then now we know that patient has to be referred, but we also should know now who has to be referred and who has to be tested. All the diabetic individuals, hypertensives, and patient with a family history of kidney disease, cardiovascular patient, and patient with obesity, metabolic syndrome, are other patients who have to be tested. So investigations mean the most important thing is to identify the risk factors and please take a very, very good history. Actually, now we can have a nurse or a self, we can give a small form to the patient. The patient can fill the basic details like age, gender, weight, BMI or the waist-hip ratio can be calculated beforehand. And he can give the history of smoking or all his personal habits and the social history, and the patient can be sent inside the clinic where the primary care physician can ask about the presence and the past history and other details, and it can be a very comprehensive workup for a patient. And next comes a simple investigations like creatinine levels. eGFR is very important to calculate. Now we have the calculators, the apps are available to calculate the eGFR. Proteinuria, nowadays we do only spot protein creatinine ratio. 24 hours quantification is not required, it is limited only for some conditions. Urine for RBC cast and all should be seen because it will help to diagnose what we are dealing with, either a glomerular disease or a tubular disease. And ultrasound is a basic non-invasive test. It can be done bedside to pick up kidney size, cortical echogenicity, and we can see for the corticomedullary differentiation. The best investigation to find out any renal abnormality initially. Renal Doppler is mainly done for a renal vascular hypertension and renal angio in selected cases. So this why we should do, whether we should do urea or creatinine, this is a common question which comes actually. So we see that creatinine is a better measure of GFR, and also it is not affected by the volume status, upper GI bleed and a corticosteroid treatment. So it is better to use a serum creatinine as compared to a pump. So why we should calculate eGFR, why not we can be happy with creatinine. So now with this chart we can see that for the same age group, patients can have different eGFR levels because of the difference in the race. So the race, gender also contribute to eGFR and the stage can vary. So it's important now that we calculate eGFR. Now the best method is CKD, EPI and MDRD with the six variables. And we have the easy access to the apps. We can easily calculate by the side of the patient. So this is just to say that how frequently the test should be done. Once the patient is in stage 1, investigations can be very simple and can be done once in 6 to 12 months. And in stage 2, urine spot has to be added to the above investigations. And every 6 to 12 months it can be done. And in 3A and 3B, more complex tests are being added and more frequent visits have to be given. So the not to undermine the importance of dietary habits and physical exercise, weight reduction, smoking cessation and alcohol reduction, the more and more patient has to be reiterate about these things. So I would request all of you to at least have some small placards. The medical reps can help, or we can have small placards in our clinics, or we can have some posters planted in our clinic. When the patient waits for the doctor, he or she can at least go through that and at least can be benefited. At least if you are able to even change the life of one patient, it will make a change in the community. This is just to show that how important it is. Just sugar control, blood pressure control, and dietary protein restriction, and lipid loading. These keep on changing actually from time to time. So now according to the GNC8, we have the targets of blood pressure being 140/90 in all the age groups. But according to the American Health Association 2017, so the targets have been reduced a bit. In elderly alone, it is 140/90. It is important to treat hyperuricemia with febuxostat, which is better than allopurinol, and it is better to keep the target below 6. Hypertension, this is just to say that it is important to use selective drugs for diabetic individuals, AC inhibitors or ARBs. Don't combine them. Prostatomegaly to be treated with in such patients, alpha blockers are better. In cardiac patients, metoprolol, bisalol or cardiolol is better. In pregnancy, please avoid beta blockers, AC inhibitors, ARBs or diuretics. AC inhibitors are mainly, they have come for a secondary prevention. They have got a role in anti-proteinuric agents. They have to be combined with diuretic or a calcium channel blocker. Better to avoid with angiotensin receptor blockers, and we have to be cautious about hyperkalemia risk. Sugar control is very important, and we have got now lot of drugs, and we should be aware about the various drugs which are acting on at different stages of chronic disease and until what stage they can be safely used. Lipid control statins have got a doubtful role in the primary prevention of chronic disease, but still, according to one study, according to the Jupiter trial, it can be used as a primary prevention. And for secondary prevention, it has to be used in all the stages. The renal safe ones are the atorvastatin and the fluvastatin, and ezetimibe can be used as a second line therapy. So for secondary prevention of kidney disease, every prescription should have aspirin, AC inhibitors, beta blocker, and a HMG-CoA reductase inhibitor, that is a statin. And aspirin and clopidogrel may be indicated for up to 12 months post-angioplasty. A word on vaccination. Hepatitis B vaccination is important because they need double the dose of hepatitis B vaccination because they are more immunocompromised, and when they need the reach the stage of dialysis, the risk of hepatitis B is more. So it's important to give double the dose. If you are giving Engerix B, double the dose. IM has to be given as 4 doses. Other vaccinations can be influenza, which is given annually, and varicella is also, especially if they are going for transplant. And pneumococcal is mainly, now we have the protein vaccine also, which is a Prevnar 13. It has to be given, and after 4-8 weeks, the polysaccharide vaccine also has to be given. And it has to be, the booster has to be repeated after 5 years. So I think the time is short. So I have spoken only about the chronic disease, what is the role of physician. If a time permits or sometime later, I can also speak about their role in acute renal failure. Thank you.
Any questions?
Actually, NSAID can cause a lot of hemodynamic disturbances. It is a contributor for hypertension, and also it actually preferentially it is also associated with nephrotic syndrome, the like minimal chain disease, and FSGS can also occur. It is also as a therapeutic agent in some conditions like nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, and also in autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease, where especially in Bartter syndrome, it can be used. So it has got both therapeutic value in some conditions, but mainly NSAIDs should be cautious because, see, every now and then we take NSAIDs. Not everybody gets acute kidney injury. So it's important that the patient should be hydrated well. And only in conditions where the vessel to the heart, to the kidney, which is around 20% of the cardiac output, reaches the kidney, if that is compromised, the risk of NSAID associated injury increases. So that has to be taken into account.
Thank you, madam. I now invite Dr. Shanti to address the vice president. Topic update.